Welcome to the Golf Smarter Podcast, Dave.
Fred, I'm glad to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
And thank you for letting me come out to your golf course today. We're at Rooster Run in Petaluma, one of my favorite courses locally. I play here a lot. It's my favorite flat course.
It is. It's a great walking course.
It's a great walking course. I walk the hilly courses too, but this is my favorite.
It is.
It's definitely my favorite flat course because there's challenge to it. I mean, it's not some of the flat courses in the area. I say that they're good for my ego, right? When I'm not playing well or I haven't played in a while, I'll go out to those courses and just like, oh, I can shoot an 80 here and I feel great about myself.
Exactly.
Then I come out here and shoot a 92. Today was driving me crazy. Yeah. But
Fred Bliss, the architect, did a great job on designing the green complexes. So it's very generous off the tee. And the challenge really happens when you're in the area of the green. 30, 40 yards from the green is spectacular.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's another, it's a crazy because there's another golf course just on the other side of, you know, this course goes long and on the other side, there's another golf course there, completely different.
Yes.
They were not designed at the same time, were they?
No, Adobe Creek was designed probably 10, 15 years earlier than Rooster Run Golf Club.
Okay.
And a different designer, of course. It was Trent Jones Jr. designed that one.
It was a Trent Jones Jr. And what happened? That's another one of those flat courses, like good for the ego, can score very well on that course.
Yes.
Except they're both, and will probably be interrupted at least once or twice. They're both, especially along your fairways here, coming on the front nine, coming back on 7, 8, 9. There's a runway, there's a private airport.
Yes.
So I find that to be very distracting. It's like I'm ready to hit. It's like airplane.
It is. It is a problem at times, especially from a teaching standpoint, because it interrupts my lessons periodically as
well. Sure. So, especially when there's guys out here going airplane.
Yeah. And there are the airplane aficionados. Everyone that flies over, they can tell you what the make and model is. And
it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. But this is a pretty vibrant course. You got a lot going on here.
Yes.
And tell me, you've been teaching here for how long?
This is my 14th year as director of instruction. And I was teaching a couple other courses in Sonoma County prior to this. When I first moved into the area in about 86, I took on with the Oakmont Golf Club on not too far from here near Santa Rosa.
Mm-hmm.
And then in 94, I moved over to Foxtail, which is just up the road.
Which is another course I like.
Yes.
And the North course, not the South course.
And then when they went under construction, there was no place to work. So I had the opportunity to come down here, and the manager was kind enough to ask me to come down and work with them.
Oh, that's great. Mm-hmm. That's great. And how long have you been teaching overall?
I was trying to think that out. I mean, it sort of varies. I started teaching back all the way in about 82.
Okay.
And I worked for a really good golf professional. His name is Mike Adams, who was just... was just inducted into the Golf Hall of Fame for his works.
Wow.
And then I came out here in 86. And so I started teaching pretty much full-time in 83. Excuse me, part-time in 83 and full-time in about 88.
Okay.
And since I've been out here, I think I've probably given close to 55 to 60,000 lessons.
Is that right?
Yeah. And this is all I do. And a lot of my clients envy me because they say, your office is the golf course? And I said... Happens to be.
So what drew you to being a golf instructor?
That's a good question. Initially got into golf instruction because most instructors are failed players, and then they get frustrated.
And should those guys be teachers?
Yeah, actually.
Okay.
Because if they have the willingness to look at themselves and say, what is it that I didn't possess? What held me back? And then become open about what that was, then they can actually provide a lot of information that would take them beyond where they would have been, but of course time and circumstance changed. So it was probably back in about 82, 83, I started incurring injuries from trying to play. Mm-hmm. And that's when I started looking into form and studying it more. And at that point, I actually became a golf contrarian. Because my belief was, like, if it's out there, I read every Golf Digest, all the books, you know, all the things that everybody's supposed to do, keep the arm straight, head down, don't sway, spin your hips, all the different things that were available to us. It was right there in print because Golf Digest had it for us. And as an avid reader, I figured I should have been able to figure it out. I mean, I didn't think a person that didn't understand things, and so I started looking at the stuff, and then it came to me in about 1982. There was a situation where I said, if this is all true, how come there aren't more good golfers, and how come I'm not better than I want to be? And even though I was a scratch, it wasn't good enough to play professionally and make money. So it became pretty clear I need to start changing the way I look at things. And then there was a wonderful book that I read at the time, and it was recommended from Golf Digest. It was called Psycho-Cybernetics.
Okay.
And
Psycho-Cybernetics
was basically a unique thing. It broke up the psyche from the mechanism of the body, and I'm paraphrasing this. And the essence of that is that the brain and the soul steer the vessel, and the body is our vessel. And if you know how to operate the vessel, then you should be able to accomplish pretty much what you need to have in life. And so the author of the book, a guy named Maxwell Maltz, was a plastic surgeon. And he got into this because he was the first one to really talk about self-image. And as we looked at ourselves from a self-image standpoint, we realized that we have multiple self-images. And because of that, you know, how you perceive yourself is every aspect of your life. You have an individual self-image for that. Are you a good golfer? Are you a great father? Are you a good husband? Or are you a good friend? Can you cook? All those things are there. And so if you take the time to develop those and you start having self-belief, then you have the ability to change and adapt and grow. And so from that contrarian standpoint, I said, okay, this information that's out there isn't exactly getting me the ability to grow. And I need at that point some information that's going to make it possible for me to make the changes so that my body doesn't continue to get injured when I practice and play golf and help me deal with my beliefs that, you know, if I was failing in performance, I was failing as a person. And that was really difficult for me at the time. So ultimately that became a transition point. Now at this point in the early 80s, I was actually working at Disney World in Florida. And that's where I turned pro. And the director of instruction there, the head, was a college mate. And he introduced me to a guy named Mike Adams.
Right. Oh, airplane.
Yeah, I'm used to this. And Mike was a very successful collegiate player, played on many tours, he played the big tour, had connections with many of the golfers of the day, and when he was at that time, and he had the same philosophy, is like, you know, it's not as it is. And so unfortunately I was behind him, but when we got together and he interviewed me for a job, he said, I see that we have a commonality here. And at that moment he hired me, and I got to work for him for about 3 years. And it was very enlightening. Sure. And so it became clear that, you know, golf wasn't about skill. It's about understanding how the body works, understanding how the mind works, understanding philosophy, and a variety of things that eventually put things together. Now,
For a golfer or for a golf instructor, you needed those understandings?
Well, as I coach, I want my students to understand that as well. If you intend to play at a very high level, I believe you have to be educated about what you're trying to accomplish. And if you don't have the clarity, then it's hard to sometimes commit to what you're being asked to do. And all my students that are playing well right now, I make sure that they understand when I'm explaining a concept or an idea to them, I want them to be able to rationalize it. So yeah, it's one of those things. I've gotten to the point that, again, contrarianism, I don't believe that golf is a skill. I don't believe golf is an eye-hand coordination game. And, you know, at that point...
You are a contrarian, my friend.
And that scares people when I say it.
Yeah, I'm like, say what? Yeah.
And the reason is because when you get into the point that you think of skills, you think that it's a talent, it's something that's there. But if we look back at Michelangelo with his awesome ability to chip beautiful sculptures out of marble, he always said he revealed them. And until he learned the ability, the structure and the consistency it took to make those little chips on the marble, the ability to control his tool, then he was able to see in his mind what he was trying to accomplish. Out of his mind came the creation. But the technical skill of chipping the marble was what gave him the ability to do that. So golf, like that, is a process. Once you understand the essence of the process, then you have the ability to create the outcome that most people that don't understand the process believe to be a skill. So it's a perception. And
and
one of the things I say all the time, golf's not an eye-hand coordination sport.
Yeah, that one I really need to dig deeper.
Well, it's pretty simple. I mean, I've given lessons to blind golfers.
Okay. You win.
And so everybody's because it's an eye-centric game, most activities, sports, other things like that, we presume that we have to see what we're trying to hit or move. But golf is a fixed position game. The ball is sitting on the ground. And if you know how to position your body and manage it in space, you have the ability to apply the club to a very precise spot on the ground consistently, whether you look at that spot or not. So eyes are not an impediment, but they don't have to be an asset. And I know that's controversial, but it's I have students all the time hit golf balls and they're not looking. And we do drills and they work on balance and the critical things. So from an ultimate standpoint, it's the effect is that because we have these strictures, you have to keep your eye on the ball, you have to keep your head down still, you have to keep your left arm straight, you shouldn't swing so fast, you shouldn't sway, stay down, keep your spine angle, all those things that are considered to be ultimate golf are actually, in many cases, symptoms of greater causes.
Keep going.
And therefore, the things that we consider to be fundamental are truly just an outcropping of something that if you do it correctly, it would happen automatically. The reason that we have rhythm in our golf swing, the reason we have the ability to keep our body center is because we have a great mechanism in us called the balance system. Mm-hmm. And the equilibrium is always trying to keep us in a very safe place. And the equilibrium in our body loves the status quo. It does everything possible to keep you in balance. The irony is it's a fail-safe system. I've never seen anybody fall over for no reason. Now, if someone drinks too much, they might fall over. That's a reason. Right. If you get an ear infection, you might fall over. That's a reason. Sure. If you get tripped, you might fall over. That's a reason. If you're so tired you can't stand up anymore, you're going to fall over for a reason. And then if you happen to expire, that's another reason you might fall over.
But gravity has nothing to do with any of this.
So ultimately, you know, if you get to the point, if all those conditions are gone, balance is fail-safe.
Okay.
And each one of us has a natural, dynamic sense of balance in relation to our feet. And when golfers set to the golf ball, the preponderance of golfers start off balance. And during the course of the golf swing...
In their setup?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And as they do so, because of that, as they operate the golf club, the stress that's put on the body from the motion of the swing requires a violent, often, reaction to keep from falling over. Self-preservation, hit a golf ball. You know, what's the subconscious brain saying to us? Mm-hmm. It says, well, why not? Let's hit a golf ball, land on our ear, and see how many times we do that. And so when golfers look stiff and they can't use their legs and they feel like they're not capable of moving and the golf swing feels awful, it's often related to poor posture and not getting into dynamic balance and understanding the essence of it. It's not that difficult to find, but it has to be found before we can really have the ability to move freely and comfortably and powerfully in a golf swing. So it's a unique process.
Wow. It's really interesting. Well, why do most golfers who are starting out, and there are many who never take lessons, so they just carry this along with them, but why are they off balance? What elements create the lack of balance? I mean, because I've seen people, you know, like their heads, you know, heads turned away from the ball when they're setting up, their shoulders, you know, there's so many things, but is there one thing that you can just like point right to it and say, oh yeah, your balance is going to be a problem?
Beginning golfers are often the first things they hear, like stand to the golf ball athletically.
Right.
Well, what does that really mean?
Sure.
Feel like you're sitting on a stool. How tall is the stool and how tall is the individual? I mean, there's too many parameters are involved in there. So in other words, the guidelines are not quite there. So when most golfers are taking to the golf club in the first time, there's nothing that we do up to this point where we have two hands on the golf club and you're leaning forward and you're trying to strike an object off the ground, because there's nothing when the hands are this close together. So that creates a different environment or sensation for the time being. Mm-hmm. Then ultimately, then someone says, well, you got to keep your head down. And then we start tipping the head down. And there's a lot of mass that goes into the skull. And as soon as you move that in front of the spine, then you're setting your body into a position of dysfunction. Mm-hmm. And then someone says, bend your knees. Well, knee bend that's incorrectly done. When you bend your knees, the flexion of the knees lowers the body and moves it to the ball of the foot.
Yes.
And when you move your weight to the ball of your foot, you are now off balance. So from that moment on, the ability to turn and use the body normally is significantly reduced, because pressure to ball of feet with knee flex is set up for one type of movement for the skeleton, which is up and forward. And that makes it very difficult for us to turn. And then, of course, someone says, keep your arm straight. And then we lock up the shoulder. And when you start moving, then it pulls the shoulder down and throws us more forward and off balance. And from that moment, we might be looking at the golf ball, but the subconscious says, let's get back to a safe spot. And then we return our body to balance into a safe position. And that's when the body comes up. And, you know, from my diagnosis, that's where people said, you took your eye off the ball, you moved your head, you swung too fast. All those are remedied by quality posture and good balance.
And then there are so many people who want to use the club to lift the ball, right? It's not about letting the club do its job with, you know, with the angle of the face as it is.
Yes.
Airplane. I you know, we may still be able to be heard. I don't know if how loud the airplane sounds to the audience, but to us it's very loud.
Yes.
So yeah, there's that element too, when people, you know, they're leaning back, right? And then they're trying to lift, they're trying to do the work for the club instead of letting the club do its own job. It's another element of being off balance. Do you find it a more satisfying challenge to get a beginning golfer or somebody who's clearly got skill, maybe a mid to low handicap player that comes in and needs some tweaking? What do you find more interesting and rewarding for yourself?
It's interesting. That question's been asked me a lot.
Really?
Yeah. And I don't, it's, this gets into philosophy a little bit with me. I love golf, what it offers. I think golf is a vehicle that demonstrates the ability of the human being to do incredible things. Mm. And when we recognize we can do it with one arena, like a golf club or in the environment of the golf course, then we have the confidence that we could probably do something in another environment. So therefore, regardless of the golfer's ability, beginners love learning. Mm-hmm. You know, they're so curious. And so when you create an environment that lets them have success, there's just an inherent joy to the initial time you do something well. It's like the first time for everything.
Right, right. Yeah, keep going. We're good. I can hear you.
Yes. That's all that counts, right? And the intermediate golfer, when they come to you, they're usually looking to problem solve.
Yes.
So they've brought their game to a point where they have some success, and they say, I keep hitting behind the golf ball. I'm losing power. I don't have the accuracy. My shots are too low, whatever that is.
And I want more consistency.
Yes.
Always want more consistency, which people don't realize how consistent they are.
Yes, exactly. They consistently do the same thing.
Exactly.
And ultimately, because of this, they then say, okay, I recognize that I have failings. And it's a revealing time. And you learn a lot about someone as an individual when they say, I'm not doing this very well. And then how open they are to taking the adjustment. And, you know, it's in a weird way, I'm allowed to criticize people.
Mm.
And I'm allowed
to. You're a teacher.
Yeah. You know, but they give me their permission. You know,
yeah,
they,
exactly.
It's something that I honor. It's not something that you should be taken lightly. Because it's like they're opening their soul up to me a little bit and say, I'm not very good at this. Can you help me? Mm. And so to that end, the relationship changes a little bit from joy of learning from the beginners to, okay, you're going to help me because I want you to. Thank you for coming into my court and being on my team. And then we investigate what it is that is wrong. And what is the malady? Is it concept? Is it is the model failing them? Is it something physical? Maybe they've got an impediment that doesn't work there. Or do they even understand how a club really works? Mm. I mean, most people think they understand a golf club and how it works. But the reality is, I can ask anybody that walks down the street and about in the golf course, and about 1 in 20 has an idea They know about the face. They know about the shaft lean. But that's about it.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, they don't have a true understanding of how this adjustment affects that, which and how does that impact the golf ball. So now you're making adjustments that will eventually influence how the ball behaves, which then the joy comes. Now I'm getting control over something more in my life. And what I learned from marriage, control is important.
And because we don't have any.
And so fortunately it's important to realize that you have to relinquish control and gain control. And so with the passage of knowledge, you give someone the strength and knowledge to be able to change something in their life. And that's powerful. And that's what there's a lot of people say. They get hooked on lessons sometimes because of that. And then you get the elite golfer that comes out and they want to get better. And I've got a couple fellows that once on the mini tour, another guy wants to play on the senior tour. And I've coached some an LPGA tour player and a few others. And in the area, maybe 25 local professionals have come to visit me over time.
That's quite a compliment.
And what this what they're looking for is the refinement.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when you have to look at them and then what is it that is sabotaging from what they really want. And many times, sometimes it's perceptual. You know, I always thought this is supposed to happen in a golf swing. And then you say, well, in certain styles of swings, that might be really good. But in other styles of swings, it doesn't work.
Hmm.
And so methods get mixed.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you know that, you know, if different types of bodies are maneuvering, not all swings are the same for all golfers.
Right.
So you have to be able to tailor that. And sometimes we miss that. Sometimes we don't even know our body well enough to say, okay, the reason I'm having trouble here is because I've got something going on in my hip that may have happened 40 years ago or 30 years ago and don't even know it until it's finally diagnosed. And then one of two things, you work around that and let it stay, or you take care of it so it becomes healthy. And so the challenge of that is looking for those things and then defining what do they really want. You know, what do they see when they analyze their statistics that keeps them from being quite excellent on the golf course? You know, why is it they hit the double cross once in a while, pull draw when they expect to hit the online fade? And so that becomes a, there is something in there that is obviously mulling around that you have to bring to the surface and help them look at. And once you bring that to light, oftentimes it takes care of a lot of itself.
What do you feel is your greatest asset as a teacher of golf?
Of golf.
And we can get into being a teacher.
Right. Greatest asset in golf. I mean, that's... That's the first time I've ever expected that question. The greatest asset in golf. I mean...
I just made it up.
No, it's a great one. I've got it. The desire to be curious.
Mm-hmm.
And my students have taught me this. It's the moment I stop being curious is the moment that I stop growing in what I'm doing. The
but
thought
you're supposed to have all the answers. That's why we come to the teacher, because you have the answers to help me, not to to learn from me.
Right.
Right.
Right. But it's relevance. You know, golf grows. We continue to get better. Equipment changes. Technology's all around us. And if we don't have that ability to adapt to technology and understand how the body works better, then it's hard to be better at what we're doing. So the curiosity, I have one gentleman that I coach, and he's got bad shoulders, bad knees, and bad hips. Mm. He's got arthritis in his hands. And he comes out, and he comes to a golf lesson, and he carries so much joy. He says, Dave, you got to teach me this today.
Wow.
And he says... And when he leaves, I mean, he's just from ear to ear, he's grinning. He says, that's great. You know, he says, and I said to myself when I first met him, this is probably 20 years ago, I said, I need to maintain that attitude.
Mm-hmm.
But in the same token, I think I've always had that attitude, because when I started playing golf, any piece of information I could find that seemed relevant, mental side, laws of physics, how a golf method works, equipment, playing the game, strategy, anything that was either relevant to golf or not relevant to golf, I would always run it through my filters. And my filters were, how can this make me a better golfer? And now, to this day, it's how does this make me a better teacher? So with a thousand students that come across my team, I get doctors and I get engineers and I get architects and I get lawyers and I get housewives and I get kids. And each one of them has something to say. One of my best lessons that I learned in putting and helped me teach was from a 9-year-old in a golf camp. And
what was that lesson? Please.
It was it was the lesson of time.
And what, did you have to put the kid in timeout? What does that mean?
Well, again, if you might remember, I'm a contrarian. I don't believe putting has finesse or touch to it. So as you're going, it's like, wait a minute, that's all I relate to. But distance control, because I'm ultimately a pendulum teacher, and in the putting stroke that I developed and use my clients almost all the time is one that is designed precisely on concepts of a pendulum. So ultimately, if I weigh the whole system against mathematical models, it technically, because of math, is virtually a perfect system. And I know it seems a little pompous to say that you have a perfect putting stroke, but I can define one.
Really?
Yes. And once it's defined, it's understood. The execution of the perfect stroke takes a little bit of practice time, and there's other forces besides the pendulum working. There's gravity and internal workings, but it's definable. And in the system, the distance control is based on the pendulum and the stroke of the pendulum. Now, pendulums keep time. And when someone says the control distance, you hit the ball harder or softer, in my world, that's a Goldilocks and Three Bears method. Too hard, too soft, just right. And that means you've got to hit thousands of putts before you get the acumen to control the distance on the greens, especially when speed changes. But in the perfect system, you have a pendulum. Pendulums keep time. Their strokes are symmetrical, so I'm the same back, same through guy. And regardless of the size of the arc that the pendulum makes, the time it takes to go from apex of arc to apex of arc is constant. Mm-hmm. So my initial way of coaching that was gravity. I base it on gravity time, the pendulum. So when you watch a pendulum swing, it always moves at the same rate. Mm-hmm. But I also know there's, in the world of music, and I'm like the most amusical person on the planet, in the world of music, there is time signatures. And you're probably blessed and gifted that you know what it is. And so this little 9-year-old says in the camp, I'm showing this group of kids, and I said, we're going to learn to keep control of distance by controlling the time or mastering the time of the stroke. And if everybody's musical, you can come up with a time signature. And everybody's always goes like 1-2, 1-2. And I hated that in a way because I could say 1-2 fast, or I could say it slow, and I can draw it out. It was never consistent. And then he let me swing the putter, and he
as long as you have if you don't have the 3-4, it's not going to be. I mean, the 1-2 is not enough.
Right,
but if you go 1-2-3-4, you've got
right
something to work off of.
So you're musical.
Well, I can count to 4.
Right. So when he did this, I swung the putter, and he let it swing back and forth. Then he started counting, and as soon as the putter was at dead center, he said 1, and then his momentum took it up to the apex of the arc. He was on 3, so we go 1-2-3. Contact was back at 1, and the club would finish on 3. So it was a waltz turn. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. 1 back, 3 top of the arc, 1 contact, 3 finish the arc. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. Then regardless of the size of the stroke that you made, you'd always be applying the same pressure. If you take the same size stroke each time, with that time signature, you would be putting the same pressure on the ball. But if there wasn't a time signature, you can go back this far and swing like that, go back this far and swing like that, and there's no distance control.
Right.
And in the human brain, that time signature becomes a mnemonic link. So the moment you start saying that, the memories of your experiences before are reattached to that. And now you have a way to build upon it. And so putting is a function of time and length.
Yeah. Oh, that's so interesting. So cool. I just noticed something on the camera. Well, we'll deal with it. Not a problem. I want to go back to Mike Adams.
Okay.
For a second, and share with me what you feel was the nugget, the greatest lesson that you walked away after working with him.
Well, Mike Adams as a mentor, never let the dust rest under his feet. He was always going. And he was always in the technology. He was always in the forefront of things. And to this day, he is. And what Mike demonstrated to me was what I didn't have the grasp of was how much physics and how much biomechanics and how much understanding geometry was important to be able to successfully identify key elements of a golf swing that need to be coached and taught. And until that moment, you know, until prior to the contrarian thing, it turned out that mostly I thought golf was a skill. I thought golf had touch and feel to it. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate enough at a young age, and I know that you might be, and I'm dating you maybe perhaps, that I, as a young man, I took lessons from Bob Toski for a bit.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And Toski was very much a feel player. And in fact, you have to feel the force before you can force the feel. And so it means that was one of his monikers. And you know, I knew what he was getting with it and everything. And we had a conversation about short game one day, and all he was talking about was fingers and feels and falling and dropping. And it was a apropos for the situation, but there wasn't really a link to it. And to my brain, maybe I've got a little Spocky type brain up here, but to my brain, it was something that was a unique experience that I could relate to my friends that didn't totally justify the means. So I got the idea, but I never was able to master the concept.
Interesting.
So again, I relished the time I spent with him, but it was at that point, I don't think it was appropriate to what I needed, even though I know he's an excellent teacher and an incredible individual.
Wow. Awesome. As we were setting up to do this recording, one of your students, I'm assuming he was a student, said,
yes,
you got to ask him about Rule of 12. Rule of 12. It's like he's the master. This is it. I had no idea what he was talking about, so I'm really hoping you can share that
with us. It's actually not a new concept. It's an old concept. I've been teaching it since 83. It's not my concept, so I can't take credit for it. So
it's okay. You can take credit for it right now. We'll let you take credit for it.
So basically, I was a fan of a short game guru, a guy named Paul Runyon.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got to see him speak many times. And his philosophy basically was use your putting stroke whenever you can around the greens because it gives your accuracy. It's the most accurate stroke that you have developed in your golf game.
Whether you're using your putter or not?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And he was so influential in the game, he almost changed the game on us. And in fact, in the late 40s, he won 29 PGA golf events.
Wow.
And the other tour professionals were very upset with Paul Runyon because he was not the best ball striker. He was a diminutive character, and he was able to play at the high level with the superior ball strikers of the day. And one year there was a little cadre of golfers that got together, and they decided, so we should keep track, so we've got some statistics to talk about what this guy's doing to the game for us. And from 10 feet off the green for an entire golf season, Paul Runyon averaged less than 2.
Wow.
So he chipped into the hole more often than he did not get up and down. So that got everybody's attention. So they're saying short game's given too much value in this game. And because of that, ultimately they said the golf hole, therefore, for the other golfers aren't quite as good. Maybe we should expand the golf hole and make it bigger so that the other guys that aren't so good with short game have a better opportunity to put the ball in the hole and compete with him in that arena. And so they actually had a demonstration tournament back in the 40s that when they doubled the size of the hole to 8.5 inches across. And the guy who won the tournament won by 8 strokes, and he was the only player in the field that didn't have a 3-putt.
Hmm.
And that was Paul Runyon. So they realized at that point short game was critical and you can't give it up. And to that day, we know that. To this day, we know that. And so after we learned that his technique, then someone slightly took what he did a little bit further. And so Runyon believed that the player of the day was changing the club's loft, like use a pitching wedge and make it less lofted, put the ball back in the stance and change your technique, a steeper angle of approach on the ball. And all those required changes. So his philosophy was very simple. He says, well, I've got a bunch of clubs in my set. And if I put the ball a little back in the stance and make a putting stroke and feel like I'm slightly chipping down on the ball, pressing down the ball to get the ball to jump up, then all I have to do is change clubs and the ball will fly at different trajectories. And therefore, the ball will probably roll out different amounts.
Sure.
So that was the father of the rule of 12.
So I'm missing where the 12 is on this.
Right. So after much study and research, people would hit chip shots and then they would make a shot. And what they found out was that if you putt chipped with a sand wedge and normal greens in this area, the flight to roll ratio, one part flight in equal part roll. If you use your pitching wedge, whatever distance the ball flew in the air with the same technique, because the ball flew lower, it would roll at a 2-to-1 ratio. One part flight, two parts roll.
Okay.
A 9-iron was 1-to-3. An 8-iron was 1-to-4.
Okay.
A 7-1-to-5. A 6-1-to-6. A 5-1-to-7. A 4-1-to-8. And there's not many 3-irons anymore, but there was 1-to-9. And if you take the club number and the roll increment number,
okay,
a 7-iron rolls 5 times as far as it flies.
Okay.
7 plus 5 is 12.
Okay.
An 8-iron rolls 4 times as far as it flies. So the rule of 12, the 12
with was... With a putting stroke.
Right. We're not setting wrists. We're not changing angles or angle approach. So it's a low spin method, which you want the ball to roll smoothly across the green. You're not trying to spin it. You're trying to get it to hit the green and then roll. And the reason you use the different golf clubs is because one of Runyon's big keys was fly the ball to the nearest level dry spot on the putting surface. And if that was 4 feet away from you, that's where you're going to hit your shot.
Uh-huh.
And if the ball was 24 feet away, you're going to have a 1-to-6 ratio, so you would hit that with a 6-iron.
Awesome. I love it.
If the ball was 16 feet away from you, the landing spot was still 4 feet, it's a 4-to-1 ratio, which would be your 8-iron.
It amazes me how often people are trying to fly the ball to the hole, no matter how close they are. I mean, they can be close enough to get... they don't understand the concept of let the ball roll as long as you can. Right? It's like they're going to try to fly it and come on high. You don't need to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's what you're saying is it's better to avoid that. Get the ball to the ground as quickly as possible and let it do its thing on the ground.
Right. And that's one of the reasons, because the shorter target you can hit to, the closest target to you is much easier to hit. I'd rather hit a target 4 feet from me landing than a ball landed 20 feet from me. The stroke is smaller, a target close to you is easier to hit. You don't get a reward for hitting the ball further into the green. You don't get a half stroke deduction because you land the ball 4 feet from the hole and then get it close and make the up and down. It's still a stroke, it's a stroke.
Right.
And ultimately, it's the real reason why that's important, by the way, is besides the nearness, is because of loft and a loft feature. The easiest club to hit solidly is the putter.
Sure.
Because the sweet spot is vertical. And the sweet spot is present. It's right there on the golf ball immediately. And the hardest club to hit consistently is one that has 90 degrees of loft, which is no such club.
Right.
But if you go from vertical 0 to 90, you go from 100% sweet spot to sweet spot.
Yeah.
So if all we have to do is then extrapolate from that, is that if a sweet spot is, let's say, 1 inch tall,
okay,
and it's perfectly vertical, when you lay it back 60 degrees,
mm-hmm,
you've now reduced the height of the sweet spot by 2/3. So that 1 inch tall sweet spot, by proxy, is now 1/3 inch tall. And even more disconcerting is when you lay it back, you put it behind the leading edge of the golf club.
Right. Which always gets in the way.
Right. So if you have a putter, you can hit the ball on the equator, above the equator, below the equator, and it's going to go. But you now have a very limited segment of the golf ball you can apply it to. So when you introduce a more lofted golf club, unless the conditions really call for it, you're now asking for more problem from a standpoint of design of the equipment. So it's fun to hit the high shot, by the way. It's very sexy.
Yes.
But from an applicable standpoint of performance and consistency, it's one you try to avoid.
Yeah. Well, here's what I love about podcasts.
Okay.
I can go back and hear this part all over again because, and again, and again, because what you just talked about on the rule of 12 and how to utilize each of your clubs with that stroke, I think is so valuable. That's something I know personally I'm going to go back and listen to multiple times so I completely grasp what you were talking about. It's not always easy to do when we're having this conversation. I'm trying to think of the next question. But that was phenomenal, and I really want to thank you so much for your time.
Okay.
This has been awesome.
I feel honored to be able to talk with you today, and thank you for inviting me to be part of your program.
Thank you. Thank you. That was great.
Click on the link below to subscribe to our free weekly interviews on the Golf Smarter podcast at golfsmarter.com.